Can I just say, we've been talking for months about what the effect of Donald Trump and comments he made would be on the Latino vote and on the vote of white college-educated women. And the truth of the matter is that, according to exit polls, the effect was not as strong as anybody would have predicted. Anybody did predict, except for maybe Mr. Trump. Donald Trump only lost white college-educated women by 6 points, according to exit poll data I saw. That's not the huge gender gap chasm that we thought we were going to see. But perhaps even more surprisingly, I'm looking at exit poll data comparing the percentage of the Latino vote that Romney got versus the percentage of the Latino vote that Trump got in four states. In Florida, Trump got a smaller percentage than Romney got. But in Nevada, in New Mexico, and in North Carolina, Donald Trump did better with Latino voters than Mitt Romney did. I mean, tell me who had that on their bingo card.
Yeah, nobody. Nobody. But that speaks to sort of taking it up to 10,000 feet here. Going back to June 16th, 2015, when Donald Trump announced, I see Corey over there, he was there, he remembers, every step of the way he announced, nobody thought he really meant it. He wasn't going to give his financial records. He did. I remember vividly the a top aide to one of the early front runners on the Republican primary contenders saying, why are you guys talking about Donald Trump? There's no way he will ever be Republican nominee. And then fast forward to all of these ups and downs that he had, and he was completely resilient for the reasons that you were just talking about. Because it all comes down to an economic message that he, no matter what else he veered off in, and he veered off in a lot of directions that his campaign did not appreciate, but he had the fundamental appeal to people who felt and feel left behind. And that was something that was impenetrable for these voters. And that is why he was Teflon Trump. And so along the way, I mean, we can chronicle it. We could sit here for 20 minutes and chronicle all of the zigs and zags of the Trump campaign, but he kept coming back it was that fundamental.
And when you look at, this is traditionally a night where we'll talk about what the winner did right and not necessarily what the person who doesn't win, the loser, does wrong. But when you look at the campaign of Bill Clinton talking to working class voters in 1992 versus the campaign of Hillary Clinton talking to voters in 2016. I don't think you got the it's the economy stupid message from Hillary Clinton that Bill Clinton and James Carville and Paul Begala and others drove home. It was a very different message. And apparently enough people in union households and in white working class households in Michigan and Wisconsin and Pennsylvania and Ohio and Iowa thought, she's not talking to me. She's not telling me what she's going to do to make my life better, and Donald Trump is, which seems obvious now, but at the time, I think probably a lot of Democrats were frustrated.
And Dan, as you remember, all of us remember a lot of those Trump supporters, and there are millions of them. I think about 55 million already have voted for him tonight. So many of them were angry at Hillary Clinton when she used that word deplorables in describing Donald Trump supporters. And they said, we're Americans. We love this country. We are not deplorable.
No question. You know, it didn't turn out to be the Mitt Romney 47% moment that that kind of, you know, sort of played on a loop. But there's no question that the deplorable concept was something that the Trump supporters embraced. I mean, how many times did we go to a Trump rally and people were wearing T-shirts saying, I'm a proud deplorable, adorable deplorable? I mean, they embraced it because they thought it was so ridiculous, because they thought that their voices, and they think that their voices should be heard too, and that Trump supporters were misunderstood, and some of them were and some of them weren't, but that's a story for down the road. But the bottom line at the end of the day is that he surprised constantly throughout the entire Republican primary season, and then he clearly seems to have continued to do that through the general.
And you know what else, Jake, he did? He showed during the Republican primary contest, when he beat 16 or 17 Republican senators and governors, so many of them had a lot more money in paid commercial advertising than he did. He had relatively little during the primaries, but he was on television clearly all of the time. And in the general election, Hillary Clinton, her campaign spent so much more money on negative ads against him, yet look at how well he has done today.
At the end of the day, it's not necessarily the richest candidate, as Jeb Bush showed us earlier. It's not necessarily the candidate that is flashier, mm-hmm. necessarily. It's the candidate that has a message that appeals to the plurality or majority of voters. And he apparently, we haven't called this race yet, but he apparently had that. He apparently, that message of jobs, border, terrorism, mm-hmm. Washington's broken, saying it over and mm-hmm. over and over again, that was appealing. People think Washington is broken. Mm-hmm. They think they have lost their faith in American institutions, including Republican leaders and Democratic leaders in Congress, including law enforcement, including counterterrorism officials, including the mainstream media. They have lost their faith. Mm-hmm. And he was giving voice to
that. And Dan, he stuck by his basic message mm-hmm. from day one. He said, we're going to build a wall. Mexico's going to pay for it. He still says that in the past few days. He continues to say that. He's going to repeal and replace Obamacare, the Affordable mm-hmm. Care Act. He still says that. He's been saying that since day one. Mm-hmm. He stuck to those messages, and it seems to have worked.
It's true. And as you're saying that, I'm thinking of Kellyanne Conway, his campaign manager's kind of her mantra. She said it to me, and she said it to both of you as well in interviews, which is her sort of diplomatic way of saying that she didn't think that Donald Trump did well when he hurt himself by getting distracted by other issues, but he did the best when he was talking about the issues. On that note, let me just tell you what she said in the Told You So tweet, kind of very well constructed, from Kellyanne Conway. Things that were true: undercover Trump vote at Mike Pence for VP, Hillary's floor and ceiling are the same. Rally crowds matter. We expanded the map.
All right, everybody stand by. It's a cliffhanger race right now. We're watching the final electoral votes come in. Let's take a quick break. We'll be right back.